In this video I want to ditch into this big box with tubes that I have gathered through approximately 40 years or so in the Netherlands. So all European tubes. And you can see quite a lot of them. And I want to pay some attention to the tubes, the type numbers and where they were used for. I'm sure that I'm going to make some mistakes when I tell something about all these tubes, but anyway, the best book to do a study on these tubes is this book, issued by De Muiderkring in the Netherlands, and also issued all over the world in many languages, and it gives a very, very good insight in the properties from all kinds of tubes, and many tubes that I have here are in this book. There is, by the way, on my YouTube channel a video about how to make a simple tube amplifier. Sorry, that is not on my YouTube channel, but it's a free download on the Lulu website. I made that tube with a ECL tube. That's a triode pentode tube. Perhaps it's inside here, I don't know. This tube originally came out an oscilloscope from 1930. This tube too, 1930 approximately. This one also. You could see that there is a kind of metal layer on the outside. It's sprayed with kind of paint that shields the grids inside the tube. So there's a shielding effect, that strange paint. This tube, by the way, from an old television set from the 1970s, typical high voltage diode tube, can handle approximately 30,000 volts or so. Nowadays we do that with silicon diodes. These ones, for instance, I hope I can find them. Nowadays we use these things as high voltage diodes. In the past, this is semiconductor, and this is the equivalent tube. They all do the same thing. Many tubes were used in television sets in the 1980s, and of course all their functions were quite comparable. EF, for instance, stands for a high frequency tube. Philips MiniWatt, developed in, I think, the 1950s, I don't know that exactly, but these tubes did not take so much power. That's why they were called MiniWatt. Also here, the layer, electromagnetic shielding, ECH, typical mixer tube from radios made in the 1950s approximately. Mixer tube. Here the electromagnetic eye to tune in on certain radio stations. You can surely find more videos on YouTube about such an eye tube. Lighted up green, the band became narrow and small, etc. when you tuned in properly to the radio station. PLS, typical European driver tube for television sets from the 1970s. This was the so-called American pin tube. It was, as far as I know, originally invented in America. And this is a tube with a steel enclosure. Also MiniWatt, made by Philips. And of course steel had good properties to make a tube, shielding, and also the capacitance inside such a steel tube was much more precisely defined. So these tubes were especially usable for shortwave receivers, etc. with a low internal capacitance. AZ1 Philips tube, rectifier tube, one of the big and the great successful tubes from Philips. As far as I know, it's a double rectifier, AZ1. Also, this is typical rectifier tube. You can also see that on the plates. These rectifier tubes are in fact very easy made, simply made. It's a kind of a filament in the middle and a plate around it, and that's it. That's all. Here I don't know what I have. The indication is gone. That's also an issue. Many indications from these tubes were fading away, but at the right moment I glued paper on it with the type number. PL, L stands for audio power tube. So I think, but I don't know that exactly, when I look again at the way the tube is made, it is a power tube, but I don't know whether it is for rectifying purposes or, say, audio purposes. Here again, UCU21, American made tube, American pin connections, made by Philips in the Netherlands. PL500 television tube from the 1970s. Well, let's look somewhat further. This is an EF80, and that was a very popular IF frequency tube in television sets in Europe, in the Netherlands, in the 1970s. It has a very steep characteristic. It's a pentode tube, and I've tried to make an audio amp with it, but I was not successful. I have to do that experiment all over again. Perhaps I will be successful in the future, but it's a project that's still on my workbench. Very popular again, the EF80. PI88 diode tube, as far as I know, perhaps I'm wrong, it has a top electrode and it is out of a television set from the 1970s, European television set. ECCH81 mixing tube, mixer. Oh, I can go on and on and on. There are perhaps more interesting things to tell. Well, this is interesting. This is the UI41. The U-tubes, UI-tubes, not the U-tube as on the internet nowadays, but that was a tube where all the filaments were connected together and then directly connected to 110 volts or 230 volts with a resistor that was temperature dependent. As a whole series was made by Philips, and in this way you could avoid an expensive power transformer. So that was the reason. For cheap radios, though, the properties from such a tube were exactly the same as, for instance, the EI. But the E series worked on 6.3 volts. And here the voltage from the filament is approximately 17 volts, as far as I know. This was a tube that I've salvaged from an old American radio. I'm almost sure that it was a Zenith radio. Don't know exactly and cannot identify the type number. I have to stop because my camera says that I still have 4 minutes. So a lot to tell about all these tubes. Well, I want to show only one type of tube, the F tube. F always stands for high frequency, so we had the ECF80, the ECF82, ECF83, etc., etc. And the P indicated that it had a filament voltage that was not 6.3 volts. But the properties are exactly the same. This is also interesting. D, the code D, means that it is a battery tube. Philips in the 50s and 60s made typical battery tubes. This is a rectifier tube for a battery radio, DI. Again, PCC, double triode tube. I hope to find an ECC, and then I have to stop because my camera runs out. Here again, double triode tube. Used in television sets for high frequency purposes. ECH mixing tube, 6.3 volts filament voltage. Well, I stop now. I have 2 minutes. I hope it was interesting. This was the big box. And here, quite a bunch of tubes, and I wish you luck. Perhaps I go on further someday, but this was more or less all to tell. Thanks for watching.